No, that's definitely the most like infamous case of it. But I agree. A lot of the maps in Splatoon 2, instead of being those long, narrow maps, they kind of just squished them. They took them all, they squished them all down. They're a lot wider than they used to be. That doesn't mean they're smaller, but it means you can get back into the action very quickly. And you have different ways of getting back into the middle that you didn't have on modes or on maps, like you said, the old port mackerel, even the new port mackerel, a lot better. But we're talking about maps here. We have our map up in front of us right now for TakeOver versus The Last Lap. We got Rainmaker on Inkblot Art Academy, Splat Zones on Sturgeon Shipyard, Tower Control on the Reef. What's your take?
Right now, Rainmaker on Inkblot Academy, that can be a cluster because the Rainmaker is stuck in the middle. It's similar to Tower Control. The Rainmaker is stuck in the middle and you have to get yourself around the one way you have to get up there, and that's to the left on either side and up straight into the area. So when you're in that middle, there's so many different points you can take that can put pressure on your opponent that your opponents will not be able to get you, or your opponents can pressure on you that you can't get to them and defeat them. Like the Jet Squelcher, the Bucket, they are going to be really well used on both teams, I assume, on both these maps, because they cover up a wide area in a short amount of time. They can get KOs, or they do a lot of damage from far away that you can't pick them off and stop them unless you have like an E4K scope yourself.
Yeah, Inkblot Art Academy is one of the weirdest maps in the game, I think, especially in Rainmaker, because it's really the only map where you've got one way that you have to go. I mean, you can take it up the ramp or you can take it up the little wall, but you're always going up that left flat area. Once you get there, though, it's a sprint to the finish. You can eat up 50 points in a blink, but the opponent knows that's the only place you can go, so they can put as many guns there as they want. A lot of other Rainmaker maps in this game, you got two or three ways of getting to that pedestal. Here you've got one, but it's so fast, so it's really interesting. I know we talked in the pregame about Sturgeon Shipyard splat zones. You had kind of an interesting take on it. What do you think about it? What's your go-to in this?
Sturgeon Shipyard splat zones, I prefer buckets because the way that the splat zones are arced, you can cover up a lot of area by keeping yourself safe as well. I mean, albeit you can also do it with weapons like Tinnitus Splatter Shot because their range is kind of perfect for that. But buckets, they just allow you to cover not only that immediate area, but you can also cover, you know, if you have control, you can cover up that alleyway that they may want to cover up. So I think Slosher, like a main Slosher, does really well on that map. At the same time, you also have two great points for Chargers or the Jet Squelcher to go in and be able to pick people off and call points off. Both being like that first wall on your side of the area, and then that tilting wall that turns up. When that turns up, everybody turns out. You can just go in and call everybody down, charge anybody you need to, especially again with the splat bomber. I'm sorry, the splat charger with his bomb rush, the fire fin. I believe it's the fire fin scope, if I'm correct, with the suction bombs.
Yep.
But yeah, the bomb rush can cover up a lot of areas. So it's a really hectic, high octane map to play on, especially with splat zones. Man, we're going to see a lot of splats from both teams. But at the same time, if you do get really good splat zone control and you can start pushing into the area, it's almost a GG for you. Because it's a really wide space between the splat zones and your area, your pit that they're sitting in.
Mm-hmm. And if they do get to Tower Control on the Reef, probably my favorite Tower Control map, because if things get going, they can snowball very quickly, because if the opponent wants to get back to you, they got to jump down. And if you've got a Luna Blaster, if you've got a Roller, if you've got anything down there that can take out multiple people real quick, it's going to be GG. So every time this map and mode comes up, you always kind of just like wipe the sweat off and say any mistake we make could be the last mistake we get to make.
Exactly. The spawning point of the tower is very narrow. It gets similar to how we dealt with it in Splatoon 1. It's a narrow area. So Lunar Blaster with a wide blast radius just does so much damage to everybody. Not to mention any blaster on Tower Control is well welcomed. Well, for your team, not against your team. But for your team, you definitely want to have a blaster without a doubt, because it just hurts so many people in a close radius, which is always going to be escorting the tower. The Reef is a map that has a lot of points, but I don't think they get the proper time to be taken advantage of on that stage. With this mode, I should say. Just because it's like the path of the tower, it's kind of awkward. I don't really know how to say it. It's just really unique to itself, depending on this stage compared to other stages. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I agree with what you're saying, and it really is three different maps in terms of the way that they're approached, so I think that this is a very good map list here to start things out with. If you're not familiar with Splatoon 2, because I know we've got a lot of newcomers out there in the chat today watching, trying to learn about this, learning about the scene, These three maps and these three modes will teach you a lot about what Splatoon can be, how different teams attack it. And like PK said earlier, we're going to be doing our best to inform you about what all's going down and why it's going down.
I do want to mention real quick. Well, actually, I want to touch on that, what you just said. We do want you guys to understand that one single weapon doesn't work on every single mode. There are some weapons that just excel a lot more, such as with Inkblot Art Academy on Rainmaker. Weapons like the Tri-Slosher, which also comes with the sub ability, the sub weapon Splat Bombs, and the special ability of Ink Armor, does a lot of defensive support for your team, because when you're going onto that left area, you can cover up a wide room and just be able to KO anybody who's trying to make a dash with the Rainmaker. And also the Octobust, which covers up a wide area as well, and also has a pretty good amount of distance, if you ask me, with the Auto Bomb that can chase down anybody who may be walking with it in the vicinity. And you have the special of the Inkjet, which again, while still nerfed, because you're all going to be focused onto that left area, the splash damage from those shots from the Inkjet is still going to do massive damage and force people out.
Mm-hmm. And I'd really be interested in seeing how much the Tri-Slosher gets used today. It's still going to be a powerful weapon, but I don't think we're going to see any three-bucket comps, as we call them, the old three-bucket. I don't think we're going to be seeing that nearly as much as we did. Get a nice little preview here. Rainmaker, Inkblot, Art Academy. Shoutouts to Nintendo giving us the spectator mode that we need. And we're getting into game number one, TakeOver versus The Last Lap. Let's go. Get hype.
These two, and look at the team composition between those. And right now we see them both running in. We have Hydra Splatting, the Forge Splattershot Pro, a new weapon, along with the Custom Splattershot Pro and a Splattershot Pro from The Last Lap. Cannot look at this weapon on TakeOver, but actually no, they have the same amount of composition actually. I'm sorry, I got swapped around. They actually have the Tentex Splattershot and Rapid Blaster with them.
Yeah, gonna see at least one or two T-Tex right here at Tef. Gonna use that Inkjet we talked about. It may be nerfed, but it can still get some damage done. Great job there, though, by Vian of The Last Lap, shutting that down. Pressuring the Plat with that is something that was very popular in the early days of Splatoon 2. Looks like it's still being used here. Both teams kind of just going with trade. You see two X's up for both sides. That is the kill count. As long as neither one of them goes down too much, a big push should happen. As you see The Last Lap trying to make an early push here, gets shut down again. Look at that T-Tex roll.
Right now, we saw him trying to go to the left side of that tank, and that's how I normally approach it anyway, is that you want to go to the part where your opponent doesn't have open approach to it. You want to try and bring that Rainmaker up to the top, because once you're there at least, you can try to walk down, but the Rainmaker is almost reset, but is grabbed by Scarfy, and now he's making the approach for his team from the left side, going up the ramp. And let's look at if anybody really did a push him, but they did take the lead right now, and he is shut down by, looks like, the four splatter spot. Yeah, four splatter shot.
Right, and it's worth noting right here, 57, not a big push whatsoever on this map. Things can go from bad to worse very quickly if you're not careful. And already another three down here. Last Lap has to be careful. They're getting taken out at a much greater rate than they are taking down. But you see all this green here in the middle. It is allowing TakeOver to set themselves up however they like and shut down any counter assaults that might be coming in. There goes that Inkjet up on the plat again. This should be a much bigger push for the Rainmaker here. Waiting to get one more down. Rob gonna try to go here, go get a little bit of shielding from that block there. Maybe a little bit further, already down in the 40s. This could be a knockout.
It's looking like it right now. I was going to say, I do appreciate the follow-up they do have, but they had a near team wipe on The Last Lap, and they were pushing it. They got the 30 points. It's actually a very secure score to have in this mode, because again, when the Rainmaker gets pushed back, it's pretty tough to get back to that point you were at, so 30 is not anything to be worried about. Just hold it down right now. They have the option of playing very defense. We have Atef playing in their zone and putting pressure on the team, getting caught though and stuffed out by Vian and his heavy splatling, taking point and throwing it down.
New killer whale, it's the new killer whale. We talked about this in the pregame. Watch it, there goes that big boom. Is that gonna get the kill? It got one, not gonna get the other one there, but we see, thank you Nintendo for the buffs. The Stingray, also known as the Goku main nowadays, very, very strong. But again, they're just continuing to put pressure on The Last Lap. The Last Lap has been playing this entire game in their plat.
Stingray got a very necessary buff. It was very often regarded as one of the lesser specials in this game, but with that wider blast radius, you can do a lot of damage, especially on Rainmaker and Tower Control, because you cover up and don't need a whole thing. So they are now pushing it. However, the Rainmaker is stuck behind the platform. It's actually in TakeOver's favor right now. I believe it's TakeOver's favor. And right now, they just have to hold it down, try to get these KOs and get themselves secure enough so they can push it. But The Last Lap is not trying to let them live up to their name.
Absolutely, and there we see it. This time, Rob's Inkjet going to take out E. There's only one left hiding right behind here, doing a great job, but not able to get the kill. That was so unfortunate. It's such a great job of waiting. Finally, the last one going down here. But you're seeing every time they get one kill, they're paying for it with their lives. And as long as the middle of this map stays green, they're not going to be able to get a lot out of it. I think, yes, the one that was out does go down. And this has just been the story of the game. That plat is still green. They're going to get another chance to make a counter push. Even if it's not winning, the last lap isn't even getting a chance to grab the Rainmaker.
Quick note about the bubbles I wanted to mention is that I love the way that they're playing it. You don't even have to really activate them because the blast radius of explosions from the bubbles aren't that amazing. However, when you just let them sit, they seem to cover up a lot of ink. And if your opponent wants to blast it and blow it away, it takes up a lot of your time, a lot of the ink, a lot of the resources. And while they're trying to blow up the bubbles, you're putting pressure on them and getting those KOs. You have an ink storm being dropped out from CC GG Gab right now, and the Rainmaker is reset. Right now, they're looking like they need to push it because they have 37 seconds left on this clock right now.
You'd like to see them build up their specials here, utilize those to try to get something. They are not using any ink armor right now, not something that's very common to see here. And Rob, again with that T-Tech, going to come and get, I don't know how many of those four he got, if he got three or if he got all of them, but that's huge right here. Going to get a chance to put a little bit more pressure on, not quite to Inkjet yet, but it's not going to matter. They're going to get the knockout just like that off of the triple there from Rob working that flank. Great stuff.
Look, the colors of that map tell a story. There was a huge skirmish, but most often than not, TakeOver had the control most of that map. They pushed it into the turf, and albeit it got reset to the middle, but they pushed it back in there, and TakeOver gets a knockout, as you said, and that splat damage. They were getting the KOs when it mattered for them.
Yeah, and we're going to talk about this a lot here. I'm glad that you mentioned the color of the map. Ink control. Ink control is a very simple term to talk about a very, very broad topic. In Splatoon, ink control means everything. It means mobility. It means the ability to play stealthily. It means special charge. It means everything. Inking is so important, and a lot of other games talk about kills and kill counts, and those are certainly important here, and we will talk about those as well. But you have to have ink control if you want to make anything happen. Where your ink has, it forces the opponent to then take it back. So it's so, so, so important to keep ink control. But then, conversely, you can't get ink control if you keep getting killed. So it's a balance, but they're both very important.
Exactly. The splats lead to lead control. It's that the ink control, as you said, is what you really want in this game. And you want to make sure you can get as much as possible. So if you see someone else covering up ink, you want to target them down. Because when you take them out, you can cover more area. You have more room to recover your ink. You have more room to throw bombs. And they have less room to even approach the target, the objective, which is right now is going to be really important moving on to Sturgeon Shipyard. As we said earlier, the splat zone is in the middle of a very, very wide stage, and you could actually say it's sectioned off into, if you're coming from your base, it's sectioned off into three areas: your base, then you have your pit, and then you have the center. And if you control the center and you start taking over your opponent's pit, you don't even have to worry about their base. You can just take over the pit and hold them down. They do have ways to flank, but honestly, the map is so wide and so open that a simple charger should be able to see where everyone is coming from and call out shots as necessary. Or anybody who is on point. Again, if you choose to rock out with the Jet Squelcher as well, you can do it with that. It's just, you have to play really well and make sure you keep that control on this map. Because if you lose it, you're going to spend about a minute trying to get it back.
That is something that's going to happen, and I'm really interesting. I believe it was Vian who was playing that splatling that we talked about. There were no chargers last game. So if that is the case again, and of course we don't know, we haven't seen the loadout yet. If they end up using that, it's going to be up to Vian to play point guard, as you call it, and call out things where they're going, because that's going to be a very dominant piece.
All right, so right now we have the Squiffer pulling out on Team Last Laugh, and TakeOver rocks out. I'm looking for their point weapon, but they don't have one, actually. They have the slosher machine, which is really well. You can see them all approaching to the middle immediately. We have a KO on this flat roller by Rob, and now he is putting pressure up there on one of their points from Last Laugh.
Mm-hmm. The Squiffer, a very difficult weapon to play effectively, as you're seeing they're getting chased down by the sloshing machine. The sloshing machine, one of the newer weapons, at least in Splatoon 2, and has been used very well, as that's a full wipe there on the part of Last Laugh. They get taken out. They're going to have a really hard time, and just like you said, now there's three ways that they're going to have to come in, and it's going to be a hard sledding getting back in. One getting spotted out here on the left. might get taken out as well. We're already almost down to 50 seconds, and I don't know if they have any presence whatsoever.
No, they lost a lot of control, and I do appreciate it. Even though they don't have a weapon to take advantage of point... He fell down the pit. But even though they don't have any weapons to take advantage of the point, what they do have are weapons to push them off of their point. That's exactly what he did. The sausage machine went right to their point and just shut them down. Right now, they are into their area. Last Lab is just trying to get back to the center. But again, TakeOver has control of their pit. They're taking them out at every approach they're making. And the unfortunate mistake that Last Lab is making is that they're not taking time to try and regroup. They're being picked off on every single corner. And TakeOver with the very clean, sharp, and quick knockout.
Methodical, surgical, any word you want to throw at it, that's exactly what it was. And I'm glad that you mentioned the Last Laugh kind of got a little bit too happy to get back into the middle there. They were kind of trickling in one by one. In that situation, you have to regroup. You have to pull yourself back together and go as a team. You're not going to win 1v1s against a game that knows you're coming and that has ink control. So, I mean, there you just saw TakeOver put their people where they needed to be, take them out one by one. And it was just too little too late. And that shows what that wipe at the very beginning of the game can do. You know, you get chances to come back, but those are certainly very difficult chances.
You have to worry about exactly where you're going. What they should have done is spent time throwing their special charge up. And as well as the Squiffer, I believe the Squiffer comes with point sensor, correct?
Yes, it comes with point sensor and ink armor.
Okay, so the Squiffer could have been throwing point sensors into the ink, and best case scenario, would able to locate two of them. That way the team knows, okay, we have two over here, take them out. We have the location right now. And the NZAP could have been pulling out the ink armor to give themselves a little bit more offense when getting back into the pit to try and take over splat zones. But what I was saying before was that you're going to take about a minute to get back into the splat zones if they take over your pit. Unfortunately, with splat zones, that clock ticks fast. Mm-hmm. And you only have a minute. You got to make sure you're quick with it. You get back to the area. You cover it no matter how you can. Whether you have an ink storm, ink storm is great on splat zones. Just to throw that out there. But if you have an ink storm, throw that on there. But you need to make sure you get back to that area as soon as possible and throw it down. And unfortunately, Last Laugh wasn't able to do that.
Yep. And that's really how it can go in Splatoon. Things can snowball very quickly, especially here in Splatoon 2, where you don't have Kraken anymore. You don't have Bubble. You don't have those... I don't want to call them easy ways, but you don't have those ways that you could definitely push back in more safely than you do now. You've got to find different ways. You've got to get kind of creative with it.
I guess you could say it was a full takeover for Team TakeOver. Okay, I'm sorry. You can kick me out now.
You know... I knew someone was going to make the pun, but I would not believe that it was one of my own who would.
I am very corny, sir. I will be the one. I promise you. But regardless, that was a really just fine match from them. Shout out to TakeOver for their understanding of the map composition, what weapons they needed, and how they needed to do it. Again, I really am impressed with the slosh machine. Not even opting to have a player on point, but the pressure. Their player that they are going to have on point. Because when he did that, that was one of the key points and to getting that immediate team wipe and shut them down.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely was. And I believe we're going to be moving on to our next match. This is going to be a best of five. It was only round one that was best of three. Right now we've got Skillink, which is our number 10 seeded team. This is one of those teams in that range that we were talking about. They're going to be up against the 23rd seed in Surge.